He is a professional who lives in San Francisco. He's from India. His specialty is computer applications. And he is actually going to talk about, so he's been wondering about God's existence. Have many of us thought of that in the last few moments? God's existence, yes, it's a big question. He's only got, 20 minutes? So Natan is going to talk about, and it's basically, it's his first public appearance, okay? So we need to make him feel really welcome, and we will hope that by watching somebody's first public appearance, you will say, I can do this too, and you'll get out in the world and start doing the same sort of communication, okay? So let's hear it for Can you all hear me all right?
Yes.
Okay. So good morning, everyone, once again. And thank you, Mark. My name is Nitin Tomar. And I would like to begin by asking a question, taking off from where Mark left. We do not have any psychic mediums in India. Okay. And don't get me wrong, we have a lot of people who are in the business of telling future. We have astrologers, you'll find an astrologer in every single home. You have palm readers, you have tarot card readers, you have people who are known as Vastu specialists who will come to your home and they'll tell you how the energy flows and how you should remodel your house to bring peace to your life. But we do not have psychic mediums. And that's my question to you, for something for you to think about, and maybe we can come back towards the end of the talk and explore this question a little bit. Maybe we have some in remote areas, but if you go to anybody in India in a urban setting and say that there's a psychic medium who can tell your future just by thinking about it, right? Or there's a clairvoyant, they will just laugh you off. They would. When I was born, the position of Mars was in such a place that the priest predicted that I'll have marital problems 30 years later. Okay, but if you tell my parents that there's a psychic who can tell you what's going to happen tomorrow just by thinking about it, they'll say you're kidding. Okay, so think about that a little bit, and maybe we'll come back to it. And before I start, a little disclaimer. I'm going to talk a little bit about Indian culture and tradition. I'm not an expert on the subject. Don't really want to be as well. So feel free to ask any questions you may have, but some of the questions I may redirect to Google. So expect that. But yeah, do feel free to explore, ask questions. I am going to talk a little bit about Indian culture just to let you know where I come from. Most of you may already be aware, India is an extremely culturally diverse country. We have 29 states. The division of states is based on the languages. So between these states, we have 22 official languages. By official, I mean that these states are allowed to do business in these languages of their own. And other than that, we have about 122 major languages that are spoken by more than 10,000 people individually, or there are about 30 languages that are known to be spoken by a million or more people. The ancient text ranges from Vedas, which were written down about 1500 BC, but they are known to have existed in oral traditions, some people believe, as far back as 4,000 years ago. And they are supposed to be the books of knowledge that have a lot of lot of rules for conduct, prayers to the gods, philosophy, things like that. Puranas are books that were written much later, but these are the fundamental basis for Hinduism as we know it today. These are the actual stories of the gods that we know in Hindu culture right now. They define the trinity of Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh, the creator, the preserver, and the destroyer. And all of the current Hindu tradition is based on the stories of Puranas. Then we have some extremely important work known as Ramayana and Mahabharata. These are actually stories written in the form of poems. These are actually pretty good reads. You know, if you get a handle on the translated versions, these are highly recommended just for the value of the story that they tell. Ramayana is considered sacred and holy. Mahabharata, not so much. It is the story of a family feud over a kingdom, right? So there are two parts of the same family, the cousins, that fight with each other for a piece of land or a piece of kingdom, which ultimately it carries over for multiple generations and then ultimately culminates into a war that lasts for 18 days and then ends everything. People are superstitious about Mahabharata. They don't want to keep it at home. They feel that if you keep Mahabharata at home, then you know it will bring issues in your family. Holy Gita is part of Mahabharata, but it's an extremely important text. It's a conversation between the hero of Mahabharata, a warrior prince called Arjuna, and Lord Krishna, who was his chariot driver. And just before the war, this prince had doubts about going into the war. He did not want to kill people on the other side who were his teachers, his cousins, his relatives. He said, I don't want this kingdom, I would rather die. Why should I go to war? And then Krishna gave him a pep talk on why he should go to war. And this pep talk is documented in Holy Gita, right? And that's where the concept of karma, the concept of dharma, the concept of death and rebirth, they are all documented in this scripture. This is again considered sacred and holy, equivalent to a holy Quran or Bible. And I used to watch in olden Hindi movies, people used to take oath by putting a hand on Holy Gita. I don't know if they still do that or not. The religious traditions also vary as you move from one state to another state. In southern states, the religious denomination, the Hindu religion denomination, are Vaishnavism and Shaivism. Vaishnavites are followers of Vishnu, Shaivites are followers of Shiva. In northern India, the denominations are Sanatan Dharma and Arya Samaj. Oops. What do you do? And how do I get the...
Laser pointer?
Here it is. Okay. Sanatan Dharma and Arya Samaj, these are opposite thoughts in northern India. Sanatan Dharma is the orthodox Hindu religion which is based on Puranas and the stories in Puranas. Arya Samaj was founded later on in 1870s by a Sanskrit scholar who insisted that Hinduism, the basis for Hinduism is Vedas, and he rejected Puranas. And as a result, he insisted that Hinduism is not about idol worship, we should not worship idols. He rejected caste system, he welcomed everybody into the Arya Samaj temples. So it was a social reform movement plus a religious apologist movement. He tried to modernize Hinduism or redefine Hinduism. Of course, if you go to an Arya Samaj temple, there's nothing there, right? Because there are no idols, so people outside the Arya Samaj sect, they wonder what happens inside. But one thing that they are famous for is getting interfaith marriages done. They have a license to get people married. So people who fall in love interfaith or intercaste, they go to Arya Samaj temple and get the marriage license. So they are famous or notorious for doing that. Then of course you have Sikhism, Jainism and Buddhism, which are offshoots of Hinduism and now known as individual religion by themselves. I've mentioned some festivals here. Festivals are a great way of understanding the complexity of the culture, right? And I'm not going to the laundry list, but I'll mention one. Dashera is an extremely important festival celebrated across India. But the underlying story, why it is celebrated in various parts of India, is completely different. In northern India, it is celebrated for when Lord Rama killed a demon called Ravana as part of this story called Ramayana. And it's a very elaborate celebration. 10 days before Dashera, people play out Ramayana on the streets. They build, you know, makeshift stages. The local actors just come in, they play out Ramayana, the story of Ramayana. And it culminates on the 10th day by killing Ravana. And we make it grand, right? So we build a huge effigy of Ravana, we fill it up with firecrackers, and then we burn it. In southern India, Dashera is celebrated on exactly the same day. So the central theme of Dashera is triumph of good over evil. In southern India, it's celebrated on the same day. The message is the same, but the underlying story is completely different. The underlying story is another Lord Krishna, another goddess Durga kills a devil called Mahishasura. Right? Now, how did that happen? I have no idea. These are probably, so Hinduism, you know, it's not a monolithic religion, right? It's a collection of all of this put together. I personally grew up in a family where, you know, my family believed in a little bit of ancestor worshipping, you know, from their native religion. Then maybe 80% Arya Samaj and maybe 20% Sanatan Dharma. Right? And so what that means is that for all the major events in our life, marriage, housewarming, we'll call a priest from Arya Samaj who will do a short and quick prayer. But when we have Diwali, which is the festival of lights, and when it's you pray for goddess Lakshmi, who brings wealth, we will bring her out, and we will not take a chance. So I grew up really between all of this. You know, I grew up in Delhi where I had friends, you know, who were here. No atheists though, right? And I don't know why is that, but atheism is not a very big thing in India. And even, you know, for myself, I took a very long time to complete this journey and come to a conclusion that yes, I'm an atheist. For a long time, I did not feel the need to do it, right? And maybe you have parked that question somewhere. So why am I an atheist, right? I feel, you know, I seem fairly passionate about the culture that I'm from. Why did I feel the need to resolve it, or why do I think that I'm an atheist? So I'm going to explore some of the questions that I grew up asking. And some of these are very simple questions that I asked when I was maybe in 5th grade, 7th grade, 8th grade. But I feel that I have sufficiently resolved this question for myself. Okay. The first question that I have is the question of appearances and miracles. In all of the traditional texts that we have read, right, and there is a publication in India that publishes comic books based on religion and based on history, and those are extremely popular. In everything that you read, there is a lot of talk of miracles done by gods, or God making appearances when their devotees call upon them. Right? And these are not just mythical stories, some of the historical people are also, so there's a poet in 5th century who's known to have, you know, prayed to a god, and then God made an appearance and then gave him a gift, and then he became a great poet. Right? Why all of a sudden, you know, ever since the advent of the video recordings and the cameras, these miracles have stopped happening? You know, this is a simple question, right? I'm sure, you know, all of us grew up asking that question, but that's the first question that I started asking. Miracles, the closest that I came to a miracle was in 1995. Then all of a sudden we woke up and everybody was running to temples because there was a rumor going around that gods are drinking milk. And it's astonishing how that happened, because it happened across India.
That's true.
Right? And everybody woke up. I don't know if it was on the news, but you know, everybody was running to temples. And I had a cousin who was visiting me. She wanted to go, and you know, I also wanted to go to see what happens. So we stood up with a bowl of milk in a line that was 3 hours long to test it out. And it did. it did really work. You know, we offered a spoon of milk to the statue of a god, and you know, now you see it, now you don't. So that was really fascinating. Until later in the evening, there was a shoemaker, there was a cobbler, you know, who claimed that he can make his shoemaking tool made of iron also do the same thing. Right? So he had a demonstration where he offered milk to his tool, and then, you know, now you see it, now you don't. Then, of course, scientists later clarified and enlightened general public on the physics of capillary action. That was in work all the time. I had this discussion with my wife yesterday, and she told me, and they were also, you know, they grew up Arya Samaji, so they did not have any idols at home, but they had a replica of Statue of Liberty at the time, and they tried it, you know, with that statue. So that's the closest that I came to an actual, you know, claimed miracle in my lifetime. And you know, I grew up wondering why that doesn't happen anymore, and that's probably when you start asking those questions. The ghost paradox, so that's the fancy name I gave to a simple question that I asked. So as when you grow up and you are sleeping alone, you are afraid of the dark, your parents reassure you that there are absolutely no ghosts. Okay? It works for me. I mean, of course, for the parents who tell their kids that they are ghosts as well. So that's a different story. But yeah, my parents would reassure me over and over again that there are no ghosts. When I was in about 7th or 8th grade, I asked my dad this question on whether he believed it. He really did not believe in ghosts. He said, no, absolutely not. Out of the question. The second question I asked him is, did he believe there is God? And he said, yes, there is God. Then the next obvious question is, how can you believe in one and not the other? Right? Either you believe in both or you don't believe in both. You have not seen both. And it was a genuine question. I was expecting an answer. But the answer that my dad gave me was a sheepish smile. Right? And I'm so thankful for him to that. And that's the first time I realized that, you know, you don't learn everything as you grow older. You know, there are some things that even the grown-ups do not know. So it's a fair game to ask those questions. Human tragedies and the relevance of prayers. Right? This is a very important question. Has been a very important question for me personally. You see, these tragedies happen all the time. The picture on the right is from 2013, 2 years ago, when there were some pilgrims who were going to a holy site in India, in the state of Uttarakhand. When all of a sudden there were flash floods, okay, and the actual place where they were supposed to go, you know. The flash flood started from there and came downstream and took everything, you know, along with them. The tragedy was so severe that you don't even account for how many people were dead or missing. Right? But the number is estimated to be in thousands. And these are the people who were going on a pilgrimage. The picture on the left, you may have seen, this is a very recent event. It happened in Pakistan, where a group of terrorists attacked a school where there were children of army personnel, and they slaughtered, killed about 135 children, right, at point blank range, just to teach Pakistani army a lesson. Now you would imagine that the little ones who were hiding under the table trying to escape would pray to their god to, you know, help them escape out of this tragedy, but did it work? So this helped me conclude that even if there is a God that created all of this, most likely, or I was, this made me almost certain that he's not running things actively in this world, right? So the things, you know, this world is running on its own. Right? So whether you pray to him or you don't pray to him is irrelevant. Right? And there are many explanations that the apologists would like to give on why this happens. In Indian culture, we say the theory of karma, you pay for your sins. Right? So if you do bad things will happen to you. Fair enough, but you do see bad things happen to good people as well. Now the explanation to that is, those are the, you're paying for the bad things that you did in your previous life. And because we believe in, you know, death and rebirth. But how do you explain tragedies of this nature, right? With thousands of people, you know, died in a single stroke. Did they all commit sins in their previous lives together? So, why conflicting messages? Okay. Now you would imagine that a God that created all of this universe is so supremely intelligent, right? We are nowhere close to that intelligence, and we are nowhere close to creating a solar system of our own, right? So that entity is so supremely intelligent, right? And that entity wants to be worshipped. But that entity could not do the simple job right, right? Which is to give a consistent message across the globe to all the people. That entity sent different prophets at different point in time to carry the message, right? And left us, and sometimes maybe slightly different message too, and left us in this constant state of conflict. Right? Why would, you know, that entity or God do that? But if you look closely, it's the method of delivery of these messages and the messages itself, they measure up to the intelligence of human beings. They do not measure up to the intelligence of a God who was intelligent enough to create a universe and a solar system and created man or set evolution in motion, whatever it is. Right? It simply does not measure up to that intelligence. I mean, we are nowhere close to that, but if you ask us to send a message consistently across the globe, we will find ways to do that, right? And lastly, how about a non-caring creator, right? So how about, you know, so we have so far, at least for myself, I've concluded that, you know, even if there is one, you know, doesn't need to be prayed because it's not impacting anything. But what about a one, whether there is one who actually created for the same reason that we create robots, right? Maybe it's a plaything, right? We don't care whether the bigger robot, you know, crashes the smaller one. Right? We created and we left it. We played with it for some time. Now, the argument against it is, number one, if there is a creator that created us but does not care, then why should we care for it? Right? And the second is an argument that was presented to me many, many years ago. It's a classic argument. Is that if the creator created us, then who created that creator? Right. And then if the creator created that creator, then who created that creator? Now it's not a very attractive argument, right? Because it tells you how something is not done. It doesn't tell you how something is done. And we as human beings, we want to know how everything is created, right? And you know, scientists are working on it, on how chemistry, you know, transformed into biology. Probably in our lifetime we'll get to know. But even then, it is a complete argument in itself that you cannot deny. Right? It does sufficiently prove that you know, there cannot be a creator, because then the creator has to have a creator. So those are the few, you know, arguments that sufficiently proves for me that there cannot be a God. Now let's come back to the question that I had for you. Why do you think that we don't have psychic mediums in India? Any explanation?
We don't have what?
The psychic mediums. We don't have psychic mediums in India.
Well, do you mean mediums as in people who say they talk to dead people?
Yes.
Ah, they've all reincarnated.
Yes. We believe in reincarnation. So there's no state where somebody's waiting out there to talk to you. I mean, that's a very unhealthy state in our country. Right. So either you get reincarnated into a lower or a higher life form, or you become one with the God. But there is no in between. If something is in between, it means you know, somebody screwed up the last rites. so that's not a very healthy situation. So that's why you don't have. We don't have business for them. So that's why you don't have. Questions.
I struggle with this all the time, the difference between an agnostic and an atheist. And you presented a good argument why there, you know, there's no proof that there is a God, but what about the approach of the agnostic to say, I simply don't know?
I don't know if agnostics, and again, I'm not a professional atheist. So, you know, I struggle with these terms all the time. I don't know if agnostics say that they don't know there is a God, or whether they say that they don't care there is a God or not. Right. So I don't know whether agnostic is one way or the other. But I call myself an atheist because I'm pretty sure that there is no God. Yes.
So just a comment. One of the reasons that you probably don't see a lot of very active atheists in India are the rather staunch blasphemy laws, where...
No. We don't have blasphemy laws in India. We have
I know for a fact that there are some atheists that are being run out of India under fear of jail.
We have very strict laws against... what do you call it? Hurting the sentiments of people. Okay? What it means is that you cannot, you know, openly make a speech and say that, you know, so-and-so God doesn't make sense, right? So, for example, Lord Ganesha is very, very big in India, right? You will see huge processions on Ganesha's birthday, right, across the country. And Lord Ganesha has a head of an elephant, right? So if someone to come up and say that doesn't make sense, you are hurting the sentiments of millions of people, right? That, there is a law against that, right? But you want to have a personal belief, and you know, you want to give a talk like this, you know, with reasons on why you don't believe in gods, that's acceptable.
But that sounds like a blasphemy law by another name, though, to say.
That's a restriction. That is a restriction on freedom of speech. I mean, I would say that. But we do not have as strict of blasphemy laws as in some Islamic countries.
So, I'm gathering from your talk that all those varied religions, they all have gods. I personally am struggling with trying to figure out whether Buddhism has gods.
So the question is whether. Sure, let me try and answer that. The question is whether all the religions that are mentioned here, do all the religions have God, or there are some religions that do not believe in God? And there is a question about Buddhism, whether Buddhism have a God or not. I don't know that for sure, but from what I understand is that Buddhists are agnostic probably towards God. Right? They don't focus on the question of God, they focus on the question of suffering. And they the key teaching of Buddhism is that everything is impermanent, you know, so you should live in moderation, you should not feel extremely happy. If something good happens, you should not be extremely sad, because everything shall pass, right? So Buddhism focuses on human suffering, but it doesn't really address the question of God, in my view. Yes?
Quick question. How strong is Islam in India?
In India, Islam is about 15%. About 80% of the population is Hindu, and about 15% is Islam and rest of India.
And Buddhism is very small.
Buddhism and very, very little. Like, for some reason, I don't know what happened over centuries, But Buddhism originated in India, but then it was even made into a state religion at some point in time, I think about 2000 years ago. But over time, as the rulers changed, they made Hinduism as the state religion. Hindus also tried to call Buddha as the ninth reincarnation of Lord Vishnu. Okay, and that some people see as a trick to get Buddhists back into the Hinduism. Yes.
The central issue to me seems, what is the definition of God? Depends on your definition of God. Is it power? Is it